Lillian worked in a newsstand. One summer, she dropped a shift. She had a free afternoon. And she made the tragic mistake of taking a community college extension course called the Psychology of Dream Analysis. Well, during the course of the course, she kept a dream journal, she did some low-level analysis, wrote a few papers, real basic stuff. For whatever reason, though, it wasn't until halfway through it all that she realized what's really the crux of this whole story. She wasn't in her own dreams. Ever. Thinking back, as far as she could remember, she had never been. Not as a visible character, or even as an invisible observer. She was always conscious of the fact that in her dreams, she was somebody else. And the more closely she looked at this phenomenon, the stranger it became. She slowly realized that not only was she consistently not herself in her dreams, but she was consistently a very specific other person. A guy in his late 30s. This guy. She didn't know him. I mean, she knew him in that for her entire life she had played the part of him in her dreams. And in a way, his face was instinctive to her. The way your mom's or Oprah Winfrey's face is. Something so familiar you don't think about it. Now, at first she framed this as, why am I dreaming about this guy? She came up with all sorts of theories, some more interesting than others. But then she started piecing everything together, and it got even stranger. She rarely remembered her dreams, and they had never really been a big part of her life. They always seemed remote, distant. They always seemed as if they didn't really have anything to do with her. When she dreamed of childhood scenes, the people and settings were all unfamiliar. And sexual dreams were all about women. Which had freaked her out in college, but eventually it just became uninteresting. The fears and horrors in her nightmares never really struck a chord with her. So what this is all pointing to is not that she's been dreaming about this guy all her life, but that all her life, she has been having this guy's dreams. So, besides developing the vague feeling of being cosmically gypped, what do you do with this information? Well, nothing. You keep ringing people up, you get a B in the course, months pass by. You think less and less about it, and it's well on its way to becoming a meaningless quirk of your psyche to be trotted out for small talk on first dates, and eventually, being forgotten altogether. Now, on some level, Lillian knew she should just let it go. Now what? What could she possibly say to this guy that would make any sense at all? She made some excuse and went on to work with her tail between her legs. And that might have been the end of that. But that night, well, things got really strange. Because he had seen her face now, and that night, when he slept, he dreamt of her. And she saw herself in a dream for the first time in her life, in his dream. She was beautiful. a sort of goddess in his dream. And she gazed at herself. And she had never, never had that before. And it was a powerful thing. She didn't want it to end. She fell in love with it. Over the next week, she tracked him down again and started casually bumping into him to keep herself fresh in his mind, so at nights he would keep dreaming of her and she could keep experiencing that. It was like a drug. She couldn't stop. Now, the tragic implications of this are, you know, looming. And Lillian wasn't blind to them, but she chose to keep going. It was worth it to her, and she wanted more. So, she initiated a relationship. For those first few weeks, their first couple of dates, she saw herself every night more and more powerful and idealized, more and more beautiful. She was missing work. She wasn't eating well, but the dreams were all that mattered. The night they first made love, the dreams after it, as much as I would like to end it there, well, the next morning came, and the next few months. The relationship played out. And of course the dreams became more and more lackluster. He dreamt of her less and less, and she was often not a goddess at all in the dreams anymore, but sometimes she was, well, like a nun, or his mother. For Lillian, it was torture. She needed that vision of herself. Now that she'd experienced it, she needed it. Her only focus became pleasing him. Trying to make him happy with her so the beautiful dreams would come back. Now, I don't know if you've ever tried to salvage a dying relationship by becoming a selfless footstool for your lover. It, doesn't work. He broke it off. And now, every night, she dreamt of his new girlfriends. And even worse, occasionally she saw herself marginalized and discarded. Her dreams became a prison of her own making, and eventually she didn't want to sleep at all. The phrase, got a gun and shot her lover down, has fallen out of popular use. It's got an antiquity to it. Things rarely come to that these days. Maybe we have more options, or girls have groups of their friends to say, girl, you got to get on with your life. Or whatever they say. Anyway, modern jilted women rarely gun their lovers down. But these were special circumstances. Billian wandered home in a daze. Fell into bed and went to sleep. Just before she drifted off, she wondered, as I'm sure you're wondering, what she would dream. Had she been set free? Would she dream her own dreams at last? Or had she truly cursed herself to hell, doomed for the rest of her life to the dreams of a dead man? Well, I don't know. The police kicked in her door the next morning to arrest her for the guy's murder. They found her in her bed, dead from heart failure. She had died in her sleep. Which happens. I wouldn't read that much into it.